Welcome to The Treatment. I'm Elvis Mitchell. The following conversation was recorded in front of a live audience as part of Film Independence at LACMA screening series. There, I spoke to writer-director Xavier Dolan about his new film, Mommy.
One of the things I love about your work, and I was telling you this, in fact, I tell people to see Lawrence anyways just because of the music. I mean, because the music is so evocative. And you were saying that you actually write with music, right?
I do. I've written a film because I had heard a song on the radio. Mommy, I wrote, for different reasons, but a friend had made me listen to one of the songs in the movie that's called Experience by Ludovico Einaudi. Yeah. The one when she sort of has this fantasy of this future life that the future she's dreaming of. There's a song playing called Experience. And when I heard that, I was like, oh, this is a beautiful piece for a scene like that. But I didn't know it would be a scene in Mommy. And I didn't know it would be, you know, but I knew it would be a mother dreaming of a future, you know, a brighter future for her son and herself, and seeing these things and these, having these visions. And then eventually I was like, okay, that's going to be in Mommy, and it's going to be with, music always comes at a very, very, very early stage.
So I was wondering for Lawrence anyways, too, that beautiful opening sequence with those incredible faces. And if there was music that came to mind for you as you were putting that together, because just, I love the way you shoot faces. I mean, you shoot like a photographer rather than a filmmaker. And I just wonder if photography is an influence for you in any way, really.
It is way more than movies,
yeah?
Actually.
Okay.
Yeah. Because movies can be very influential and very, but photography is inspiring, truly. And when I prepare for a movie, what I do is that I buy books of photographers' works, and I just collect all these images. You know, I mark pages with posters, and then I bring this to a photocopy center, and then they see me and they're like, oh, no. And then I'm like, yes, me again. And then I explain, you know, well, you know, and then they photocopy all these things. And then I put together this sort of a lookbook, which my mom's calls scrapbook, which I really hate because it's such an awful confusion. Anyway, so
it's a very mom word, though. Scrapbook. It's a very mom word.
Did you do your scrapbook? No, I don't scrapbook, you know. I don't. Anyway, there's this lookbook, and it's all of the, you know, all of the images that I've seen. Some, there are a lot of paintings too, but it's mostly photography from, you know, strong imagery that I love from either Nan Golden or,
sure. Yeah.
Nan Golden for Mommy was all over the, yeah. Ballad of Sexual Dependency was very, very, was the main inspiration of for Mommy. But then there's also Wolfgang Tillmans and Ari Markopoulos and Larry Clark. And there are so many great photographers, and it's always very inspirational because it's very inspiring. I mean, because you see these photos, and what you catch in that imagery is just a small detail, and you add that to your scene, and it brings you completely somewhere else. And the inspiration that stemmed from the photo can not necessarily be identified when you're watching the film. Whereas when you're watching someone else's film, you know, you see the work and you can't help but be contaminated by something, and then you just reproduce things. And so I really find true inspiration in images, and sometimes actually literature and even fashion magazines, more than by watching someone else's movie. I watch movies. I love watching movies, but not in preparing a film.
Because I can't help but think but the Céline must have been a big influence on you. The literature, the writing of Céline.
I thought you meant Céline Dion. I was like,
no. No, you're not that French Canadian. I wasn't doing that to you.
Well, I mean, she's in the movie. I can't exactly completely dissociate from her, but I mean,
no, not completely, but
so Céline was a big influence on you.
Yes, tell me about the way she influenced you. Yes.
I mean, the literature of Céline, like Voyage au bout de la nuit. Yeah, I haven't read Céline.
You've read Maupassant, though, I'm guessing.
I have.
Those short stories of his, I mean, that there's always somebody looking towards the future and somebody who's stuck in the present. That kind of disconnect between, and they can't communicate.
I've read some shorts when I was in high school, I guess, and I was sort of obsessed with him because the first short story that I read from Maupassant was, I don't know what it's called in English, though, but it's in French it's called, and I hope I'm not wrong, and you're going to be like, this is Proust, you're dumb. You're dumb and empty. You should leave.
They say it about me, not you.
Le Orla, this is Maupassant, right? Yeah. I would love to make that into a movie eventually and adapt it into a movie. It's such a fascinating novella. Is it a novella? It's so well written. It's so good.
But just that psychology of these people who are that there's somebody, and often in these movies too, there's somebody who's trying to sort of escape that family and escape
or society.
Yeah. And that sort of thing that kind of runs through him too is in the movies. I always feel that there's somebody, often a parental figure in your films, who is just trying to maintain the status quo, and the young people are trying to get out. You know, they're looking towards the future, and they're not understood because they have this eye towards getting out. And that fascinates me about your work. It's a kind of a singular thing for you. And I guess I wonder where that comes from.
You mean the need to break free?
Yeah.
But I wouldn't necessarily only say that it's for the young ones and that the parents are the figure of you know, authority, because I've had parents that were completely rebellious and completely, you know, like in Mommy, Andor Val's character is, you know, she's not exactly trying to maintain order, and she wants to break free too from society, from the, you know, they're adults, but it's not about the kids, you know, trying to be free. It's about people, whatever age they are. In Lawrence, they are in their 30s, and there are parents who are extremely stiff and who have very traditional values and who want to bring them, you know, back to a certain lifestyle, and they want to break free from that. But they're 30, and in Mommy, it's basically every character in Mommy has that problem with authority and society and how society, you know, wants to label things and put people in boxes and in ghettos, and it's about breaking free from that ghetto and existing in the eyes of others and trying to define who you are and realizing that you can't really define who you are through other people's eyes because people are scared of difference. These are the concerns of my characters all the time, is that who they are will not, they won't fit. They won't fit in society. They won't be accepted. So it's about that angst and that fear of not belonging. And it's about how society ostracizes them too. And it's mostly also always about characters who are experiencing ephemeral love. They meet, or they already know each other, if it's the mom and the son and I killed my mother, and they, there are the tribulations that lead us to the climax, and then in the end, you know, they go separate ways because life drew them apart. Life is dividing people, in spite of all their efforts and endeavors, and they haven't surrendered, but life will separate them. It's like that in Lawrence anyways, and in Tom at the Farm, and in Mommy, I guess, too, with Kyla and Di.
Tell me about your first meeting with Andor Val, because she's such an incredible part of your work.
And tell me about your first what?
With Andor Val, the first time you met her. What that was?
Oh, the
like.
First time I met her.
Yeah.
Well, Anne is a stellar. She does extreme, very, very good voice work too.
How you know her from your voice work?
Well, no, I knew her from all of the other things, you know. She is, you know, she's done she's stage and TV and everything. She's touched to literally every field of acting. So she does voice work, and I do voice work too. I've been doing voices dubbing movies in French since I'm like 8 or 7. And one day I don't remember what I was going to dub, but I was going to the third floor, and I went to the second floor to, I don't know what, probably just distract someone and be annoying. And I walked in the studio and I heard her voice, and I recognized, because you're in the dark, you know, when you're dubbing a film. So I couldn't see her, but I was like, ah, that's her voice. And I was maybe 14 or 15. I think I was 15. And I just walked in the studio and the soundman was like, what are you doing? No, you can't. And I was like, and I just got in the studio and I said, I'm so sorry to interrupt, but I love you so much. And I've written the script and it's called Pink Wings. And it's about an angel who will help a young gay man. And they were like, we're recording something right now. And I'm like, yeah, I'm sorry. Where can I send it? And she was, I think she was sort of, she was being very polite, but I think she was also, you know, if I would have been like 17, she would have probably slapped me and beat the shit out of me. But I was very young, so she couldn't really do anything. I think she was sort of amused by the fact that I would be pitching the script to her while they were recording. It was like, it was such bad timing and such a poor knowledge of your environment and people's limits.
Which, it could be one of your movies, basically.
Exactly. Anyway, but then afterwards we met and I called her and I saw her in various plays and the first scripts I had submitted to her were awful. And she called me back one day and she said, I've read your script. Well, it's interesting. and then I was like, oh, I know it's really bad, but don't worry. I don't want to do that anymore. I've written another one and it's called I Kill My Mother. Can you read it? And then she was like, well, I just read that one. And I was like, yeah, I know, but forget about it. And then I was like, but this one, this is what I'm going to do. This is my first movie, I'm sure. And it's called I Kill My Mother. And I hope you like it. And then she read it and she liked it. And then we shot it. And then da-da-da.
But she, I wonder what you responded to in her, because she so often in your films plays a character who feels too much, like she can't help herself, that she can't help but be moved by something. And it's such a powerful kind of vein you've tapped in her. And I wonder what it is that made you write that kind of character for the play so often.
You mean what made for her or for
you? Were you writing that kind of, because often that character that she plays, somebody who can't help herself, she can't help but feel things. Like she's sort of defenseless in some way. She can't edit her feelings. She's open to the world.
Most of my characters are like that. They're all people who have very poor control over their, well, not very poor control, but who are not seeking control of their emotions. And they're not trying to tame them, or they're not looking to unleash all that emotional, but they're not really thinking about it. It's very Latin. It's very, I think they just, because I'm thinking of Anne, and I'm thinking of Suzanne and Lawrence anyways too, and I'm thinking of the mother in Tom at the Farm. Yeah. I love characters who, I think that in life we, well, what I know of it, and I'm only 25, but you know, I was brought up by women and I've been watching people since I'm 4. Because I love watching people, and I record their not record in a creepy way, like with a machine record and whatever. Let me play it for you here. I have this amazing laughter that I heard on the bus. I've always paid attention to the way people laugh, the way they walk, their gait, their tics, their the way they blink, the way they, you know, that's always been, and I've been watching a lot of women when I was younger. And when I started writing movies, I guess, it became a sort of opportunity for me and the women from my youth to experience a different life in film than they have experienced in their own real reality life. Yeah. In life, we don't tell the waitress, stop asking me questions, you're being indiscreet, and you are humiliating my friend. In the real life, we don't tell the principal, how dare you speak to me, you know, that way, and tell me how to bring up my son, and who the fuck you think you are. You know, we don't say these things. We don't verbalize these things. I think sometimes we do. I do, actually, but every once in a while. But what I mean is that we often mute these voices and these needs for, you know, expressing ourselves. We let things go and not really let them go, because we keep them inside ourselves, within ourselves. And I think that film is a great opportunity to let them out and let people speak. Maybe in a very ham-fisted way, maybe in a you know, maybe it won't work. Maybe they won't succeed in the end, but at least they tried. And that's why I love characters who are very, you know, well, not verbose, but very expressive and very, you know, who are not afraid of their feelings and afraid of telling people the truth and being authentic and screaming and shouting and, you know, screaming freedom or I am free in the middle of the street, because we're not really going to do it in real life. So, yeah.
Well, it's funny you're talking about watching or paying attention, and there's a real watchful quality. That's the reason I talked about photography, because I'm so aware of the camera watching and that painterly quality. I'm thinking about the scene in I Kill My Mother where he's sitting with his teacher in the diner, and there's that backdrop behind them, and it looks this is combination of painting and photography, and it's just a still photograph with just it feels, and the way you shoot the skin has a sort of luster of Larry Clark and Nan going, we're so aware of the skin on people's bodies and what that heat communicates. And I get the feeling you watch people a lot too, not just to listen, but you're also just looking at their faces and paying attention to them. And that's something you bring to the movies. Was that a goal you always had, or did it just happen as you started to shoot them?
What exact goal? You mean watching?
That watchful quality in the films and that.
Well, I think that, you know, there's the script and you know, the bigger scheme of things and the big lines. And then there's what's in between. And with the actors, we can explore things in details. And for me, details is what makes it, the details is what makes it alive and what makes it something people can relate to. It doesn't matter if it's a life they've never lived or a situation they've never experienced. Detail is what they will, what I will personally as one of the, you know, someone who goes in the theater and enjoys films, every sort of entertainment, details is what I will hold onto to really understand in a sensorial way, an experience. And so I think that with the actors, when you're saying about, you know, watching people in the portraits, and it's really about adding all the little details, you know, from life, these things that I've been watching forever, the way someone, you know, blinks, or, and then Andor Val, is a watcher too. And every actor that I worship and that I love, I think is a watcher, is someone who enjoys watching people, admiring qualities in people and their flaws too, and the way they, you know. So when you add all these details, I guess that you have portraits of human beings, and that's when the character really leaves the page and starts moving and exists. It's not only a, you know, figurine.
We'll talk about this in a little bit, and something that really sticks with me, just the last 10 minutes of the movie. I mean, that great scene with the two women when there's that talk about hope, and there's a sense of dread building up me. I'm thinking, please end it here. Please, please don't take me back to that hospital. Please, I can't. My heart so goes out to him. And that's such a beautiful sequence. We're feeling, you finally get a chance to sort of take a breath, but then you take us back. And it's almost like Hitchcock as these guys are talking around him and they're really not paying attention to him. What made you go back to the hospital for that last scene?
Well, it's a movie about freedom, and he's never really going to be free. So I feel like someone has to win, right? It's not going to be Di, because she's pretty much lost everything. She's lost her new friend. She's lost her son. She's lost her job, but that's completely irrelevant, I think, in the scale of things that she's going through. That is the least of her problems. But anyway, she's lost so much. And then the neighbor has been delivered, I would say, has been delivered, yeah, has been freed of her own demons, I would say. She grew through that dynamic, but now she's leaving, so we don't really know what she's, you know, is she going to be all right? She seems better than when they all started, you know, hanging out and everything, and when she inserted herself in that household for the first time. But him, I couldn't think of Steve as someone who would be, you know, in a straitjacket for the rest of his life or for the next years, you know, and I think that he understood in his own special way of seeing life and seeing things that it would be a very complicated existence in a system that ostracizes different people, but only different people, but people like him who are more than different. They are also problematic because they're expensive. People don't want to pay, you know, for people to get better because it's expensive. And people are like, yeah, but what about the money? What about economics? What about this and this? And they're like, yeah, but what about these kids that we could, you know, help? Not only give them pills so that we maintain them in the same status, and instead of changing that status and improving that status, and so it's also about all that. And I think that there isn't a lot of hope for him. She says there is hope. Well, that's what she says
because she wants to believe it.
Yes, she wants to believe it. She believes it, and she says, "I win." She really means it. But life is, you know, it's not a fantasy. It's not a dream. You know, she's not winning. And when her friend is crossing the street, you can see her, you know, trying not to cry and doing that sort of grimace. And she really looks like her son in that moment. She looks like her son who was crying before. And so I felt that ending the movie on her would have been really nailing down the fact, you know, confirming that yes, there is no hope, and I've mocked her and I've disrespected her, and the movie ends on someone crying. I feel like it would have been cheap to her and the story, because what people so far, and maybe I've been lucky, and that's not representative of how people feel about the film, but so far when people talk about the film, they talk about the luminous scenes. The scenes that are very, you know, that are filled with light and hope, and they talk about the scene when they dance all together. They talk about the scene when they bike on Wonderwall, and when he, you know, stretches the frame and the aspect ratio and everything. So I've realized that even though the last minutes of the movie are sort of painful, it's not what they will remember of the movie. It's not the darkness of the film. It's not the dark, you know, chasms in which the characters have thrown themselves, or the violence, or the how it was pounding on the wall, or it's not what they remember. It's not what they talk about, at least. So I started to think about why, and it just made sense. And I think it is because when the movie ends and when Steve starts running, what you see on his face is not the dramatic face of someone who's like, death. You know, it's someone who's free, and he's running, and he's smiling, and he's, you know, he's sort of there's something going on in his brow, or I don't know, he's like, he's very determined, and he's running, and he's fierce, and he's free. And I feel like even though you know that he is going to shatter that window and probably die, you smile with him, because the way society and everything has been organized now is that that's maybe a better ending for him. I don't want to say it is, but it never is. But anyway,
oh, it's a beautiful film. Like, I can't thank you enough for doing this. Let's thank Xavier Dolan for being.
That was Xavier Dolan speaking about his new film, Mommy. Thanks to Film Independent and LACMA for letting us record. For more information and tickets, visit filmindependent.org/LACMA.
Take KCRW on the go with our KCRW radio app for iPhone, Android, and BlackBerry devices. Listen live, get your music fix on the Eclectic 24 channel, or hear the latest headlines on our news stream. All of our podcasts are available on demand as well. KCRW is on air, online, and on your mobile. Go to kcrw.com/apps and download today.